فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
فصل. So look how humble he is. He's trying to say to you, my book is only, it consists of fusul, which is a what? Units. My book is only, it consists of units. Fusul. He even more humble is what he said after that, which is fusulin min usul al-fiqh. Min what? Min usul al-fiqh. The word min shows what? The word min shows tab'idiyah, some units. It doesn't consist of all units. It only shows some units. Then the author, rahimahullah, he went to and he got into the defining of usul al-fiqh bi'atibari mufradayhi, in terms of its what? So when the scholars are defining usul al-fiqh, what do? They define it in two ways. One is the definition of usul and fiqh, which is called bi'atibari mufradayhi, and the second one is بإعتباره فنن أما بإعتباره علما لفن. And the second one is in terms of it being a science that's studied right now, which is what? أصول الفقه together. So the first one is, and the poet, what did he say? والمفرد المركب والمفرد المركب إن والمفرد إن تركب مع اسمه حتى أتم لقبا فحده يكون بالإفراد لكل واحد لدى النقاد ثم يعاد ثانيا مركبا إذ لقبا لديهم تركبا والمفرد المضاف إن تركب مع غيره. This is what it is. والمفرد المضاف إن تركب مع غيره حتى أتم لقبا فحده يكون بالإفراد لكل واحد لدى النقاد ثم يعاد ثانيا مركبا إذ لقبا لديه متركبا. So they define it first, أصول and فقه. Then they go back to it, ثم يعاد ثانيا مركبا. Then they go back to it again as though it's a مركب. And they define أصول and فقه together. And that's not just أصول الفقه, but it's any sciences that are like that, that are compounded of two words. The scholars, what they do is they break it up, they define each one individually, and then they define it together. So now what he's going to do is define usul al-fiqh and explain it as what? Explain it as two components, which is usul and al-fiqh. So the author says, وَهُوَ مُؤَلَّفٌ مِّن جُزْئَيْنِ مُفْرَدَيْنِ. It consists of two words. أحدهما, the first one is الأصول, والآخر, the second is الفقه. فالأصل أصل ما ينبني عليه غيره. What's أصل? What's the definition of الأصل? The author, he defined أصل to mean ما ينبني عليه غيره. And this definition of his is the linguistic lexical definition, which is أصل is anything something is built on. فَالْأَصْلُ مَا يَنْبِنِي عَلَيْهِ غَيْرُهُ. It's what something is built on top of it. We say this is أَسَاسُ الْبَيْتِ, the foundation of the house. Everything is built on top of the ground. The usul can be, is two types. An asl, which is hissi, tangible. You can touch that. You can put your hand on it. Are you with me, brothers? Another one is not tangible. Okay, it's ma'anawi. Allah says in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. This one is ma'anawi. La ilaha illallah is an asl. Touch it. You can't touch it. Are you with me? Your father is the asl. You're the fara'. Can you touch it? Your father is the asl, you're the fara', you're the sub-branch. You're a production of your parents. Are you with me, brothers? This particularly, what does it mean? It means, and it shows that this person comes from this. This is in terms of its what? In terms of its in terms of its linguistic meaning. The author now has only defined it according to its linguistic meaning. But he hasn't defined asal according to the istilah. Are you with me? The technical meaning is qawa'id mustamirra. It's continuous principles. If somebody asks you what's the asal, the technical definition is qawa'id mustamirra. Continuous evidence, from a continuous principles. That's what the usuliyin refer to as asal. There are other usage that they use it for, but this is the most common usage for the word al-asal, which is qa'idatul mustamirra. Why is the author mentioning al-far'u? He mentioned asal, we get it. Why is he mentioning al-aslu? The reason why he's mentioning the asal is for two reasons. Number one, أنه مقابل الأصل. It's the opposite of الأصل. It's the opposite of الأصل. ومعرفة مقابل الشيء تعين على معرفة الشيء بنفسه. If you want to know something, it makes it more understandable if you learn its opposite. If somebody doesn't understand tall, if you say to them short, and they know what the word short means, you just say it's the opposite of short. It's the opposite of what? It's the opposite of short. The second reason is because the person who studies usulul fiqh, he needs to have some ground in furu', which is fiqh itself. If you want to study usulul fiqh, you have to have studied some fiqh issues. Because the examples that the scholars in usulul fiqh are going to use are fiqh related issues. And fiqh is a fara', it's a sub branch. It's a furu', whereas usulul fiqh is what? It's ijmali, it's comprehensive. That's why he mentioned it. Then the author, rahimahullah, defines what fiqh means technically. And he says, وَالْفِقْهُ مَعْرِفَةُ الْأَحْكَامِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ الَّتِي طَرِيقُهَا الْإِجْتِيَادِ. So he mentioned three things in the definition of a fiqh. When he defined fiqh, he brought together three matters. أَوَلُهَا, the first one of the three is what? That the fiqh is it's ma'rifa, it's perception, and it's knowing. Number two, that ma'rifa tata'allaqu bil ahkam al-shar'iyya, it's connected to the ahkam of the sharia. And the third thing is the ahkam al-sharia is known through ijtihad. That's what fiqh means. So if somebody asks you what does fiqh mean, what do you say? According to the definition of the author, it combines three things. Ma'rifah, number one. You have to know. The second thing is, what do you know? What do you learn? Al-ma'rifatu tata'allaqu bil ahkam al-shar'iyya. It's connected to ahkam al-shar'iyya. The third he mentions is أن تلك الأحكام الشرعية تعلم, it's known بطريق الاجتهاد, it is known by the path of اجتهاد. We'll know what اجتهاد means. It means personal deduction. It's take and it's known through what? Independent reasoning and all of that. So what did let's go back to the first definition, the first point of the definition of al-fiqh, which is ma'rifa. Ma'rifa means what? Ma'rifa means al-idraq, perception. A perception that stands in the mind of the person is called ma'rifa. And that ma'rifa can be based upon ilm and ghalabatul dhan, high perception. Pay attention to that. The ma'rifa, it encompasses al-ilm, knowledge. And it also encompasses high perception. Allah says in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم المؤمنات مهاجرات فامتحنوهن الله أعلم بإيمانه فإن علمتموهن مؤمنات. How do I know she's a mu'mina? Can I really know if somebody's a believer? Because the ayah says if the believing woman come to you and they run away from the disbelievers and they come to them to you Muhammad. And Allah says, فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتِ. If you know them, عَلِمْ عَلِمْتُمْ. If you guys know them to be believing women, how do I know that they're believing women? غَلَبَةُ الظَّنْ. Eye perception. صح؟ There's a brother, you're striving. Every day you see him go to the masjid for Fajr. He doesn't know you can see him. Sometimes you bump into him onto the road randomly and you see he's got a mushaf in his hand. He's reading the Quran. You bump into him. One day, his living room window was open and he was praying in there. He didn't know you knew, because he didn't. And you went by his house and you heard him crying. What would you say about this person? That he's a righteous person. Are you 100% sure? Is it based on certainty? That's ghalabatul dhan. Ghalabatul dhan. High speculation and high assumption tells me that this person is what? Are you with me, brothers? Now this dhan is not the dhan that Allah is talking about when He says, إِيَّتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ, that they follow speculation and assumption. This is not what He's talking about. Huh? Naam, without certainty, naam. Or there is no external things that are making you come to this conclusion. It is the dhan that is, the dhan that is done without any reasoning is blameworthy. This one, I look at all of this. وَلِذَٰلِكَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word sometimes dhan as even ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does He say? وَقَالَ لِلَّذِي ظَنَّ أَنَّهُ نَاجٍ. Nabiullah Yusuf, when he said to the one he thought would leave, Yusuf alayhi salam, what did he know with knowledge? He knew with knowledge. He's wahim min Allah. بعدالك Allah says, ظَنَّ. Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala used it. أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَ مِّنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوا وَمِنْ وَاسْتَإِنَّا صَفْحًا. يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ. What's the beginning of the ayah? الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ. These people ظن, it's not ظن, speculation and assumption. They يعلمون, it doesn't mean ظن, it means يعلمون. أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ, that they're going to meet their Lord. They're the believers. Are you with me, brothers? So the word ظن sometimes is used as what? It's used as علم. So the first one, which is ma'rifah, it encompasses al-ilm and it also encompasses al-dhan. Then the author, the second part, which is mentions al-ma'rifah tuta'alaq bil-ahkam al-shar'iyyah. It is connected to what? Al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah. Al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah that the author here is talking about is al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah tut-talabiyyah. Al-talabiyyah. Because according to the usuliyin, scholars of usul al-fiqh, and the bahth al-fiqhi is الأحكام الشرعية is طلبي. Meaning the أحكام الشرعية is two types. I think we already touched on this when we were speaking about before this, we just even spoke about it. Now before this, another book. We spoke about it نعم in ثلاثة الأصول. Which is that the أحكام الشرعية is two types. الأحكام الشرعية which is طلبي. And al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah, which is what? Khabari. Ahkam al-shar'iyyah, which is talabi, which is you're being requested to do something. And there's another type of ahkam al-shar'iyyah, which is what? Al-khabari, information that you need to know. Not nobody's requesting from you to do an action, they just want you to information that's being given to you. Are you with me, brothers? So here, when the fuqaha say al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah, they don't mean khabari. Who's the one who deals with ahkam al-shar'iyyah al-khabariyyah? Kutub al-i'tiqad. Books of aqidah are ahkam al-shar'iyyah al-khabariyyah. That's why some of the scholars, they call their books fiqh al-akbar. Are you with me? The reason why they called it Fiqh al-Akbar is because when they were defining Fiqh, what did they say? Ma'rifatu al-Ahkam al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyyah, they meant al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyyah al-Khabariyyah, Khabar. The third point that the author mentions, which is al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyyah التي طريقها الاجتهاد, that its path is what? Is ijtihad. Fiqh, the Ahkam al-Shar'iyyah, is connected to ijtihad. The way you reach it is ijtihad. For them, if you did not reach this conclusion in this mas'ala with ijtihad, فَلَا يُسَمَّى فِقْه. You're not called a faqih. For them, you don't have the rights to be called a faqih. And this is not called fiqh if you haven't reached this with ijtihad. So according to the usuliyin, fiqh is what? Masail ijtihadiyah, right? As for the fuqaha, it encompasses both. Are you with me, brothers? According to the fuqaha, if you bring it with it, if you come to the conclusion with this, in what? Masail ijtihadiyah or masail which is other than ijtihadiyah, for the fuqaha it's the same. As for the usuliyin, are you with me, brothers? Now I ask you a question, brothers. The author said something, and that which the author said is ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyyah allati tariquha al-ijtihad, in which its path is al-ijtihad. Its path is what? Its path is ijtihad. What about if you ask me a mas'ala? You come up to me and you ask me a particular mas'ala, and I haven't got the answer for it. I don't have a ma'rifah, I don't have an understanding of it. Am I called a mujtahid? So am I called a faqih? Because the condition of a fiqh is first of all ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyyah allati tariquha al-ijtihad. For them, I have to have reached this conclusion by ijtihad. It has to be ahkam al-shar'iyyah. And I have to have ma'rifah of it. When you ask me, I had no ma'rifah of it. Am I a faqih? Yeah? According to the definition, no. And this is where some of the buhuth and the discussions of the ulama ignited. A lot of discussion occurred from this. Which is, na'am, the person is a faqih with the condition that he is able to quickly get that matter within a very short period of time. So you ask him a mas'ala, he says to you, look, I'll do I haven't got istihbar with me right now, but tomorrow come to me, I'll give you a good answer, inshallah ta'ala. He just needs to quickly look at things and that's it. That's called a faqih. It doesn't go against the fact he's a faqih. Because one is able to get things from a very short place. Whereas the other one is what? The other one is istihdar. As soon as he's asked, he gives the answer. He has it ready, prepared, organized. All the i'tiradat and the oppositions that you might throw at him, he's able to respond to it as well. They're both called fuqaha. Like in the one who's not called a faqih, he says, give me a year, give me a month, I need to do proper research. This is not a faqih. Faqih is a high level. Naam. Before you go into each part, I'm going to question you guys before we move on to the next one. I'm going to give gifts out, inshallah ta'ala. Each time I'm going to give one book out, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah? Yes, this is the sad thing. There's nothing we could do, because even if they do answer, who answered it first? And sisters, they will love it. But it's sad. Asaf al-Shadeed. Okay, the first chapter we took. Hayya? What did the author say that his book consists of? Four chapters. Four chapters. Yeah, what is it?
Introduction.
Dalil. الدلالات التعارض والترجح. Very good. تفضل. Let's move on to the next chapter. تفضل هي. تفضل. I can only give one book per time. Now I only ask one question. Next round I'm going to ask two questions. The round of three questions, four questions. Inshallah, be sharp.
والأحكام السبعة الواجب والمندوب والمباح والمحذور والمكروه والصحيح والباطل وفي نسخة الفاسد. فالجواب ما يثاب على فعله ويعاقب على تركه
ويعاقب
على تركه. والمندوب ما يثاب على فعله ولا يعاقب على تركه. والمباح ما يثاب على فعله ولا يعاقب على تركه. والمحذور ما يثاب على تركه ويعاقب على فعله. والمكروه ما يثاب على تركه ولا يعاقب على فعله. والصحيح ما يتعلق به النفوذ ويعتد به. والباطل ما لا يتعلق به النفوذ ولا يعتد به.
The author رحمه الله تعالى, he finished. In the previous chapter, what we did was, we defined usul and we defined fiqh. Brothers, pay attention here. We've just now finished defining what? We defined what usul meant. We defined what fiqh meant. صح? When we were defining fiqh, a term was in there. What was the term that was in there? معرفته الأحكام الشرعية. The author now is going into explaining what أحكام الشرعية is. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense now? So he's still in the he's still talking about issue related to fiqh. We're now going to go into, when defining fiqh, we said it means to know the jurisprudent Islamic rulings. So what does jurisprudent Islamic ruling mean? What does it mean? So now that's where we're going to go into the issue of al-ahkam. Are you with me, brothers? So he says, wal-ahkam sab'atun. The ahkam are what? Five.
Seven.
Five. Five of them are ahkam taklifiyah. And two of them are al-ahkam al-wad'iyah. That's where the five all comes together. So the ahkam al-shar'iyah is two types. How many types is the ahkam al-shar'iyyah? The Islamic jurisprudent rulings are how many types? Two types. The first one is called al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah, al-taklifiyyah. Five is what he mentions from them. He mentions al-wajib, wal-mandub, wal-mubah, wal-mahdur, wal-makruh. Five. Then the author mentions the second type of al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah al-wad'iyyah. And how many types does he mention in there? As-sahih wal-batil. As-sahih wal-batil. He mentions those two. So we're now going to define what it means al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah al-talabiyyah, al-taklifiyyah. What does it mean? What does the first type of al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah mean? It means خطاب الشرع أما خطاب شرعي طلبي. The taklifi one, ahkam al-taklifi means الخطاب الشرعي الطلبي المتعلق بفعل العبد اقتضاء أو تخيرا. الخطاب الشرعي الطلبي المتعلق بفعل العبد اقتضاء أو تخيرا. It means the addressing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is connected to the action of the slave. It is connected to the action slave. It's connected to the action of the slave. Iqtida'an means what? Ayn talaban, iqtida'an means to come with. It's connected to it in terms of coming with something. Aw takhyiran means in terms of his choice. Iqtida'an, four things fall under it. And takhyiran, only one falls under that. Are you with me, brothers? One more time. At-taklifi means خطاب الشرعي الطلبي. It is the Sharia addressing a matter, and this matter that the Sharia is addressing is basically connected to your actions. It's talking and it's addressing your actions. Now the action, the way it's addressing it is اقتضاء أو تخييرا. Iqtida'an means what? It means to come with something. And that the way that the Sharia will tell you to come with something is in four ways. The iqtida' is four ways. It will tell you to come with something in a forceful manner. Forcefully, come with it. This is wajib. Or it will request you to come with something in a recommended manner, which is mandub. Or it requests from you. So the first request was what? Iqtida' means to request. Iqtida' means a talab. It means requesting something. So the first thing that Sharia does is it requests from you to leave off something in a forceful manner, which is wajib. على وجوب على وجه على سبيل الوجوب. Leave it. I'm على سبيل الإلزام. The Sharia says you have to leave this or else I'm going to punish you for it. The second one is it requests from you to come with something, but not in a forceful manner, in a recommended manner. If you do this, I'll give you this reward. This is where mandub comes in, or sunnah, mustahab, and everything, they come in here. The third is the Sharia requests from you to leave off something in a forceful manner, which is haram. The third one is, the Sharia requests from you to leave off something in a forceful manner. And this is what? This is tahrim, haram. And the fourth one is, the Sharia requests from you to leave off something in a recommended manner, which is karaha. Takhyiran means mubah only. It means you've got a choice. Whether you want to do it, you can do it. Takhyiran is mubah. If you want, you can do it. If you want, you can leave it. That's how all five are ahkam with taklifi. Does that make sense, brothers? Ahkam with taklifi is something connected to your actions. Wajib, is it connected to your actions? Nah. What about mandub? What about tahrim? What about karaha? Are you with me? What about ibaha? All of them are connected to your actions. That's what taklifi means. Are you with me, brothers? It's got something to do with me. It's connected to my actions that I have to come with. It's not connected to anything external. The second one, like in ahkam al-wad'i, is khitab al-shar' al-talabiyu al-muta'alliqu bi-wad'i shay'in alamatan ala shay'in. The wad'i is what? Al-khitab al-shar'iyu. The wad'i is what? Al-khitab al-shar'iyu. The Sharia is addressing and requesting for something. Al-khitab al-shar'iyu talabiyu. The Sharia is addressing something, requesting for it. Al-muta'alliqu, but it's connected to. Al-muta'alliqu, it is connected to. بِوَضْعِ شَيْءٍ عَلَى شَيْءٍ بِوَضْعِ شَيْءٍ عَلَامَةً عَلَى شَيْءٍ. But it's connected to placing something, a sign for something else. In other words, it's got nothing to do with you. مُتَعَلِّقُ بِوَضْعِ شَيْءٍ عَلَامَةً عَلَى شَيْءٍ. It's connected to something else, got nothing to do with you. For example is, the entering of the salah time. This is a hukm taklif, a hukm wad'i. It's got nothing to do with me. I'm not the one who's meant to bring the sun out and make it dhuhr time. But the minute this sign occurs, a hukm taklifi comes from this. Are you with me? Brothers, I am not requested to come with this sign. But I am requested when this sign comes to do something. The doing that I have to come with later is called taklifi. This sign that the Sharia placed is called ahkam wad'i. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? The sun, the day, the أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر أقم الصلاة طرفي النهار وزلفا من الليل. These are timings that the Sharia puts. When Jibreel came and taught the Prophet Dhuhr time, Asr time, Maghrib time, Isha time, these are ahkam wad'iyya, signs. Isha enters, I have to now do something, which is that it's wajib for me to pray. So what's the thing that they have in common? And what are the things that they're both different in? The thing that they have in common is the ahkam al-taklifi and the ahkam al-wad'i, both of them are connected. First of all, they are khitab. They are both khitab, they are addressings, both of them. A command and a prohibition is connected to it. The second thing that they have in common is they are talabi. The Sharia is addressing. A request is connected to it, a request. What is it that they are different in? What they are different is, one is يَتَعَلَّقُ بِفِعْلِ الْعَبْدِ. One is connected to the slave's actions. And one is connected to the signs, not you. Who is the one that's been commanded? And who is the one who is being addressed here? Is different. One is you are being addressed. You are the one who's been requested to come with this. It's connected to you. You. But the other one is not you, it's the sun and the day and the night. Allah is commanding that. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's khitab is directed at that. Does that make sense? That's the difference between ahkam taklifi and ahkam al-wad'i. Its types is five. The author mentioned only two of them. But we would have to mention the other three he missed. Because without it, we won't understand the last two that he mentioned. And that is shart, sabab, and mani'. Shart, sabab, and mani'. Shart is a prerequisite. Are you there? Shart is a prerequisite of something. The difference between a rukun and a shart is that the shart kharijun an mahiyati shay. Shart is not part of the essence of the thing. It's outside it. Whereas the rukun is inside the thing. Like reading Surah Al-Fatiha is a rukun because it's part of the salah, it's in the salah. Whereas wudu is not part of the salah. It's outside the salah, before the salah starts, it's what you need to come with. Are you with me? The shart doesn't negate the fact that it can be inside the thing, but it stands outside it first. It can, some shurut, they enter mahiyatul shay, they enter the thing itself. Because the wudu, you can't say it's only needed before. So once I go into the salah, I can break my wudu. No, you can't. Are you with me, brothers? Whereas the rukun, on the other hand, you only, do you read Fatiha before the salah or do you read it when you're in the salah? Once you're in the salah. So the first one is, from the ahkam al-wad'i, is shart, condition, prerequisite. So let's take the salah as an example. Wudu is a what? It's a shart. Okay, what's the sabab for the salah to be prayed? What's the reason? دخول الوقت, the time entering, right? The time entering. What's the mani' that might prevent a person from praying? Huh? Sanity, junoon, and things like that. Are you with me? If the aql, the person goes. You can do the same with debt. There's a condition, there's a prerequisite. There's a condition, there's a prerequisite, which is a shart. There's also a sabab, and there's also a mani'. For example, the zakat. How much is it? The zakat is something you have to pay, right? What's the shart of a zakat? Yeah? That it reaches its nisab, it reaches the amount, right? Are you with me, brothers? Then what about the sabab? Hala alayhi al-hawl. The whole year goes by. A yearly cycle goes by, right? What's the mani'? What's the thing that can prevent you having to pay zakat? Debt. Are you with me, brothers? If debt comes, I don't have to pay the zakat. Are you with me, brothers? I'm a person who doesn't have the money. Pay attention. When the shart is intact, the sabab is found, the mani' is missing, this is then called either sahih or batil. Does that make sense? If the conditions are there, the prerequisite, the shart is there, the sabab is found, the mani' is missing, there's no mani' here, there's nothing preventing. Are you there? We call it salah, which is sahih. Sahih, prayer correct. Now, many people conflate two things together. When we say your salah is sahih, we're not saying your salah is accepted. That's between you and Allah, we don't know. But the author explained it to you when he said sahih, it means what? Sahih here means a ma yu'taddu bih, it's taken into consideration as a prayer. Wa yata'allaqu bihi an-nufud, and it is considered as execution, that you executed this ibadah. Meaning, تَبْرَأُ بِهِ ذِمَّةِ, the prayer is no longer requested from you anymore. But if I see a person praying right now, he leaves, the conditions are missing from him. He just wakes up, he's sleeping, I can see him sleeping. He wakes up, and he goes, Allahu Akbar. What do I say to him? Your salah is batil. Why am I saying it's batil? Because a shart is missing. Sah? A condition is missing. Are you with me, brothers? But what about if he prays with the tahara, with everything, and he does everything, faces the qibla, prays correctly, he prays with tuma'nina, he comes with everything that's needed from him. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. What do I say to him? Salatuka? Sahih. Meaning it's accepted. No one's going to tell you to pray again. The other time, I was going to tell you to pray again. Because your salah was batil. But your salah here is nufud. It's basically done. As for whether it's accepted or not, that's your intentions. Who are you doing it for? I can't look at it. Are you with me, brothers? So this is the ahkam al-taklifiyah that the author, rahimahullah, here is mentioning. Are you with me, brothers? Which is al-wajib, والمندوب والمباح والمحظور والمكروه والصحيح والباطل. And each one, he defines what it means. He defines each one. The first one, he defines al-wajib. He says, what does wajib mean? ما يثاب على فعله, you're rewarded in doing it. ويعاقب على تركه, and you are punished for leaving it. This is a very loose definition on the author's side. Very loose. Because there are people who leave wajib and Allah doesn't punish them. And there are people who do wajib, there are people who leave wajib and Allah doesn't punish them. And there are people who do wajib and Allah doesn't reward them. So when the author says, يُثَابُ عَلَى فِعْلِهِ, he's rewarded for his actions, Allah تبارك وتعالى may not reward that person, so what are you going to say? So that's why the scholars, they defined it again by saying, يَسْتَحِقُّ فَاعِلُهُ الثَّوَابِ, the one that does it deserves. He deserves to be rewarded. يَسْتَحِقُّ, استحقاق, حق. Right. Are you with me? These ones, they came back in response and said, no, 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 I'm still going to stick with my previous definition. ما يتابع على فعله. Why? Because we know that maybe not everybody it will happen for, but as long as there's a group of people who are going to be rewarded for the action of wajib, then my definition stands. Are you with me? As long as there's a people who are going to be rewarded for doing this obedient act,